Good morning. Let's stand together and sing our call to worship, Majesty.
Majesty, worship His majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory. Jesus the King, Majesty, worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Let's take a moment and turn around and let's greet each other during our call to worship.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to First Baptist Church. We are so glad that you guys are here with us this morning. Just to let you know, our offering boxes are to the side and in the back. And if you are new with us, in the back of the brochure, there is a little card that you can fill out, and you can also drop in those boxes as well. But thank you for being here, and praise God. Thanks.
You know, I mentioned the trees last week. All week long, I've been driving around going, ooh, 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 ooh. So it's been a beautiful week, and let's sing together as we sing about the mighty power of God. Let's stand.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained a sun to rule the day. The moon shines full. I sing the goodness of the Lord and fill the earth with food. He formed the creatures with His word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how Thy wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread, or gaze
be seated.
Good morning. We have children in our children's moment this morning. Praise be to God. These are some of our VIPs here at First Baptist Church Cape. And so this morning, we're going to talk about, I know all of these kids play sports, play music, are very intelligent and make very good grades in school. So we're going to talk about achievements and awards. So I want you all to show your hands. Don't holler, okay? That's me, I holler. But anyway, who has won an award or a ribbon or a trophy or something? Hands. Okay. Lucas.
Football.
For what?
Football.
Football.
Wow. Hannah, what'd you
win yours for? For being really nice at school.
Yay. Maddie.
For something in school, art or whatever.
Right. Macy.
Soccer.
Luna.
Soccer.
Rory.
Soccer.
Indy. Okay, Indy has not gotten to play organized sports or anything yet, but she's pretty well behaved, so we're going to say she gets an award for that. So there are lots of awards and lots of recognition that we receive as we go through life. One thing that we want to recognize someone this morning, because every week when we come into the children's area, I don't know how everyone else's area is. I can only imagine that it's as good as or better than ours. But when we come into the children's area, Miss Megan every week is so excited about how clean it is. And do you know who we have to thank for that being so clean? We have Miss Ruby to thank. So here's a little relaxation award for Miss Ruby. Can you take that down to her? Thank you, Ruby, for your hard work. Now, you know, we worry a lot about if we're going to come in first in something, or if we're going to be the best in something. And that's good. Goals are good, and it's good to do the best you can. And I want you all to always know that as long as you do your best, that's always going to be good enough. Whether you come in first or you don't place, or maybe you don't achieve what you want to achieve, as long as you do your very best, then that's all that you can hope to do. But the greatest thing of all is, no matter what, no matter how good we are in sports, how smart we are in school, how nice we are, how kind we are, if we believe that Jesus Christ was born, that he died on the cross for us, that he was raised from the dead, and that he ascended to heaven and sits with his Father God, if we believe all that, then we're always going to be first, okay? So when you're having a bad day, a bad week, always remember, I'm going to give you something so you'll remember. Always remember to keep your eyes on Jesus and to always put Jesus first, because did I lose my juice? No. With Jesus, everyone's a winner. Okay? Always. no matter what. So I want you all to always remember that. There he is. I'm a kind of a bag lady today. So I'm going to give you all something, and I've preserved it in a nice plastic bag, so it's COVID friendly. But I want you to put this on your dresser or somewhere so that you're always reminded, so that you see it if you've had a bad day. It says heaven on it, okay? So this is what we all need to strive for. This is what we all need to set our sights on. Yeah, it's fun to be first in soccer or first in football or get an award for being nice, but this is the ultimate prize, is to keep our eyes on Christ and know that we are always first with him. Okay, let me hand these out. Okay. Everybody's first with Jesus. Lucas. Okay, let's say a prayer. Will y'all say a prayer with me? Okay. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for these children and for what they mean to our church and for their energy and their enthusiasm. And Lord God, we pray that you will help us as a church to raise them up and train them up in the way that they should go. Help us, Lord, to be good examples for them. And Father, just be with them, wrap your arms of protection around them, and help them, Lord, to know that with Jesus, they are always in first place. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
The scripture this morning is from John 21, verses 9 through 19. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This is now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. And after this, he said to him, "Follow me." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're so pleased to have our friend Trudy Lee back today. She is a friend to our church and a friend to many, and she is here to sing for us, and it's always a very special treat to have her with us.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend to me, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubt and fear. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step may see, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, so I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
Would you sing with me, please, as you remain seated? Wonderful Words of Life.
Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Wonderful words of life.
It is bad when you have to go around because there's no handrail that is accessible on the side. As you hear the words of the prayer, please silently speak to God the name of yourself or of another whom you know has the needs of the kind that we're mentioning. Let us pray. Father, we have gathered here to worship you together because we need to feel your presence in one another, remembering that you know each of us with our varied personalities and aptitudes and needs, and that you delight in our presence even as we delight in yours. We know you walk and run with us every day on all of our paths, but we treasure this time to just sit quietly with you and know that we can rest in your love as shown us in our Lord Jesus. Thank you for the faith you've given us. We thank you for hearing our prayers, and we ask you to teach us, comfort us, forgive us, strengthen us, guide us, heal us, all according to our individual and our group needs. Lord, we pray for courage for those facing the need for medical procedures to affect your healing of their bodies, and for those facing the knowledge that their healing will not come for this body. We pray for patience to live our daily lives with the modifications that remain prudent in these times of still spreading infectious disease in our world. We pray for encouragement, especially for our congregation's leaders as they strive to serve others of us struggling for a grasp of normalcy. We thank you for the messages you send us through Reverend Rudolph's sermons and for the music prepared to guide our time of worship and reflection. We pray for comfort for all of us as we remember loved ones who have graduated from this life, while even our shared grief could not be expressed in our customary ways of community. We pray for hope for the many who do not know you, and for our direction in how to show them the life you have for them. Now, Lord, open our eyes and let us see the glimpses of truth sent by thee. Amen.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Dear Lord, let it be, let it be. Dear Lord, let it be. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Take it to the Lord in
Thank you, Trudy. I was talking with an individual about church. This individual had attended church as a child, had been fairly faithful to go with his parents and others in his family up through about high school, but when he went off to college, he did as many often do and stopped attending. And going forward from that point in life, he just continued to not attend and to get further and further away from church. And for all intents and purposes, he gave the appearance of never looking back. His wife attended where I was pastoring, and of course, you know, one of the joys that pastors often get is, you know, someone wants you to go talk to their family member. They want you to go talk to their friend, they want you to go talk to their neighbor, and so she wanted me to go talk to her husband and to get him to come back to church. And so I made time and I went and spent some time with him and talked with him, and we talked about various different things, and we were having a pretty good conversation until I went and messed it all up and brought up the subject of church. And I could tell the topic was not welcome. He didn't want to talk about it. As the conversation continued, he tried to deflect, he tried to dodge, he did everything he could, and finally resorted to humor and let me know that this was not a serious conversation with him. I asked him about coming, and he made this statement that many of us have all heard, "Oh, if I came, the roof would probably fall in." Well, I assured him that the church was structurally sound and that that was not the way God worked. And so he continued to assert that, well, he just couldn't come. It wouldn't be a good idea. He would be a hindrance. He would be a distraction. And finally, he got a little more serious, and he said with all the time that he had spent moving away from God and not going to church and everything else, that he was just too far gone. He had it in his mind that he was beyond hope. He was beyond help. He had been going down the wrong path too long, and there was no turning back. Now, while redemption is always possible, no matter how far you've gone, redemption is always possible. And I will tell you that no matter how many steps you've turned and walked away from God, the step back to God is one, and God allows U-turns. We often find people working from that premise of being too far gone, that they've done too much, that they've been away too long, they believe that there is no turning back, they've crossed the invisible point of no return line. And sometimes, even if they are doing good things, there is still that mindset of they have committed the somewhat unpardonable sin or something, and they are untouchable or unredeemable. As we look at our passage for this morning out of John 21, this may very well be where Peter sees himself. Because as we look, we see Peter is doing something that is completely different than what Jesus has called him to do. And not only is he doing it, but he has led others to do the same thing, and they have followed him. And now they, plural, aren't doing what they, plural, are called to do. And yet it is in the midst of all of this that Jesus speaks directly to Peter, and he shows Peter that he has a purpose for him, that he has a plan for him. And no matter what in Peter's mind that he has done, that he is still useful to the kingdom and useful to Christ. And so this morning we're going to look at what Peter learns and see what we ourselves can learn today in 2021 from this passage. The passage says, I'm going to read John chapter 21 verses 1 through 19. I let our scripture reader read a part of that, so I'm just going to read verses 1 through 8 so you don't have to listen to me read forever. I saw those smiles. But let's turn to John chapter 21 and we'll read verses 1 through 8. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twelve, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. And they said to him, we will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. The disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 300 yards off. As we look at this passage, the very first thing we see is we find Peter is fishing. Some have speculated why Peter is fishing. They speculate that Peter has returned to fishing and he has left being a disciple. And let me say that as there have been numerous different speculations, numerous different ideas about what is or isn't happening here, Scripture is really silent on this topic. We have no indication that Peter is or is not a disciple right now. We have no indication of why Peter and the others are fishing. Peter asserts that he is going fishing in this chapter. I'm going fishing. That is the extent of the explanation we get. We aren't told why. Does he go to eat? Because you got to have something to eat if you're going to eat. So he's going to catch some fish to eat? Does he do it to have something to do? Since Jesus has physically gone, they can't stay with him like they have, so what's going on? Or is this Peter's new gig in place of what he had been doing as a disciple? Perhaps he's going back to life as usual, life as it was before Jesus. We don't really know. Or perhaps there's just a different reason. Jesus has returned, and while that is great, while that is exciting, if you think about things from Peter's perspective, that also complicates things. Because we all know who Peter is. We know what Peter has done. Peter has denied Jesus 3 times. After Jesus has told him that he would do this. So Jesus already knew this was going to happen. He's predicted it. But Peter has adamantly disagreed, said forthrightly, "Oh no, Lord, no, the rest of these heathens may deny you or may abandon you, but I will not. I will die with you." And exactly what he has promised would not happen is exactly what has happened. He is denied, and that would have been a terrible thing, to deny Jesus while he was on trial, to deny him before he had died. That would have been horrible. But how much worse? How much harder to live with now? Because now Jesus has been resurrected. It's a glorious thing that brings hope, that brings salvation. But for Peter, there's got to be that overhanging question of, well, what happens now? How do I go forward now? What can I do now? Jesus doesn't seem to be holding grudge, but he really hasn't been around very much. He's appeared on Easter Sunday. He's given the Holy Spirit to the disciples. The next Sunday, he has appeared again and spoke specifically to Thomas, who has said, "I won't believe it unless I see it." And as Thomas has expressed his doubts, Jesus has showed Thomas his hands. He's shown him his side. He's told him not to be unbelieving, but to believe. But he still hasn't interacted a whole lot with Peter. The denial hasn't been brought up. It's still out there. And if I was Peter, I know it would be weighing on me. I have no reason to believe that it's not weighing on him. How will they go forward? It hasn't been brought up. Jesus' expectations of Peter, they haven't been discussed. Peter's status among the 12, his status with Jesus, it just kind of appears up in the air. And I suspect for Peter, he would be no different than we are. And probably fears the worst. I won't ask for a show of hands. But you know what I'm talking about, right? Something messes up, or you do something bad, you respond poorly, and you immediately begin to think the worst. Worst case scenario is, and we instantly assume the worst. We interpret everything negatively. We even expect the worst because of what has happened or what we did. And I fully expect that that's a part of what's going on with Peter, at least in the back of his mind, if not in the forefront. And while Peter isn't certain how he goes forward with Jesus, while he isn't certain how things progress being a disciple, assuming they progress at all, while there is so very much uncertainty out there for him, there's one thing Peter is certain about. He knows how to fish. He's been doing it for a long time. He had a business with his brother Andrew where they fished together with James and John. He had a fishing business. He knows about fishing. This he can do. And so he turns his time, his energy, his attention, his focus toward fishing, because fishing makes sense. He's always been a fisherman. He can always be a fisherman. This is something he can do even if he can't follow Jesus any longer. And so he focuses his energy, his time toward what he is able to do. And so Peter announces in verse 1, I am going fishing. For whatever reason, he makes his decision about what he is about to do. He makes a decision to go back to what he has known. This should be easy for him. I mean, this is somewhat normal for him, like second nature. He can do this. Where what he has done before with being a disciple and following Jesus, well, not sure how we go forward with that, but I can fish. And so Peter seems pretty decisive about this. I also notice that as Peter says, I'm going fishing, there are six other disciples that say, we will go with you. Andrew, who used to fish with Peter, the sons of Zebedee, James and John, who also used to fish with Peter, Thomas and the others, we really don't know what all of their occupations were, but I notice that they are willing to go. And I see that all seven of them went. All seven of them are willing to go with Peter to go fishing. The other six are willing to follow him. And one of the things I think we often need to recognize is the influence not only Peter had, but very often the influence that we have. Because while Peter seems to be somewhat directionless and wondering how things are going to go and what he should be doing, man, they're willing to go along. They are willing to follow, and he has some influence, some ability to lead these men and what they are going to do. And I think very often we fall in a very similar category to Peter. We don't think about the decisions that we make or the ways that we act or the way that we have influence to lead people. But there are people who look to you. And some of you are saying, they don't look to me. I don't have anything great or wonderful. I'm not marvelous or some stupendous leader. You have influence over people. And people look to you just like they looked to Peter. And so we need to be conscious about the decisions that we make because we all influence. I look at my passage and they pile into the boat. As a matter of fact, John tells us that they go and they fish all night long. And you know how it would go. Gather the nets, get them straight, throw the net out into the water. You hear it slap the water as it lands. The net sinks down. You wait. You pull the net back in. You get the fish out of the net, straighten the net back out, wash, repeat, and rinse. Wash, rinse, and repeat. It's the same thing. You throw it, you pull it in, you pull out the fish, you throw it back out. And so this is what they have done all night long. But as they've done this all night long, there's only one problem. That thing that Peter said, this I can do, this I know how to do, this should be easy. It's like riding a bike. They catch absolutely nothing. Not even a cold. You'll get that in a minute. But they've thrown their nets, they've pulled them back empty, they've repeated, they've worked at this all night, and they've literally caught nothing. Now, people familiar with the Sea of Galilee will tell you that night fishing is better than day fishing. They will tell you that it is easier to catch fish at night than it is during the day. And as you catch the fish at night, you can sell freshly caught fish in the morning, which is better for business. It was not uncommon for them to fish at night. But as they have done this all night, their efforts have been fruitless. What should have been easy, well, it wasn't. What should have produced all kinds of things didn't produce anything. And as I said, something for Peter that he has done for a long time, if not all of his life, brings about zero results. They catch nothing. And so while Peter tries to fish, and evidently the other disciples try to fish as well, this is not what he is called to be doing. This is not what the other six need to be doing. And you see, they get no results. Because this is not God's plan for Peter. This is not God's plan for the other six. God has a bigger plan, a better plan, a kingdom plan for these men. Just after daybreak, Jesus is standing on the shore and he sees them out about 300 feet from the shore. And so he asks them, "Hey, y'all got any fish?" Now he knows the answer to that question. He knows they haven't caught a thing all night. But I think part of what he wants them to do is he wants them to think about what they're doing. And he wants them to think about why they are doing it and why they are there. He wants them to see the results of doing something that's not God's will, God's plan for them. He calls out to them if they have any fish, and they answer no in verse 5. And you can almost hear a hint of frustration as you read that in your head. No, we don't have any fish. No, we haven't caught anything. Why are you still talking? Jesus tells us the disciples don't even know it's Jesus, but they do respond. Well, then Jesus does something a little odd. He gives them direction. It's always interesting when God gives us direction, isn't it? He tells them to throw their net on the right side of the boat. And if they do this, they will find some fish. Well, they cast their nets. And it says when they cast them, they catch lots of fish. Lots of large fish. The net is so huge, or the catch of fish is so huge, the net is so full, they can't haul it into the boat because it's so full. If they haul it into the boat, it's going to swamp the boat. Peter still doesn't seem to be in tune with what's happening around him or who has helped him catch these fish, but the beloved disciple gets it. You notice that he understands who's talking to them. And after the statement about catching the fish, casting their nets on the right side and getting the great catch of fish, beloved disciple understands, he recognizes who this is that's talking to them. And he says, "It is the Lord." And while the others don't see, the beloved disciple recognizes the risen Lord and brings their attention to him. But as we look at this passage, we also see that Jesus goes on and asks Peter where his heart is. Peter comes ashore, the disciples come to shore, Jesus feeds the disciples. When they get ashore, they see this charcoal fire. There are some fish on the fire and some bread, and Jesus tells them to bring some of the fish that they've just caught, and he says, "Come have breakfast." And we see that Jesus feeds them. He takes the bread and he gives it to them. He takes the fish and he gives it to them. It's reminiscent of when Jesus fed the 5,000. Also, the imagery of taking and giving and them eating even has overtones, images of communion. But we see that Jesus feeds them. But when breakfast is over, Jesus directs his attention squarely on Peter. As we said earlier, Peter is the one who's struggling. Peter is the one who determined they were going fishing. Peter's the one who led the other six out there. He's the one who's having a hard time with his denial and how he goes forward with Christ and the kingdom. And so when the meal is over, Jesus has a conversation specifically with Peter. When the conversation starts, you get the impression that Peter and Jesus are having the conversation with the other disciples, at least in the background. By the end of the conversation, when you get to verse 20, it looks like Peter and Jesus have been walking, so maybe they start there and they walk. But the beloved disciple is actually following them. But Peter is asked the same question three different times. Jesus speaks directly to Peter about how things are, and he says, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Now, these are important questions for Peter because notice what he questions Peter about. Because Jesus is questioning Peter about his affections, about his heart, about his priorities. Peter, do you love me? Do you love me more than these? And if you look, that is actually the way that the question is worded the first time he asks. But it's a question about, Peter, what has you? What's most important to you, Peter? Do you love me, Peter? Do you love me more than these? Now, I'll say it's a bit of a confusing question, and commentary writers have discussed this for decades, even longer, asking the question, what is Jesus asking Peter here? What are these? The word these is a plural word. He doesn't say, do you love me more than this? He asks, do you love me more than these? But in the Greek, the word can be translated two different ways. It can be translated as a masculine word, like these people, or it can be translated as a neuter word, these things. Now, it would seem odd for Jesus to say, Peter, do you love me more than these guys? Because that's just an odd question in general. Do you love me more than these guys? Am I more important to you than these guys? Or even, do you love me more than these guys love me? And suddenly it becomes a competition? Neither of those really make sense. Peter would have no reason to compete with the other six. Jesus would have no reason for them to compete in that manner. Jesus wouldn't make it a contest, who loves me more? The most likely translation for these is the neuter word. Peter, do you love me more than these things? And I think Peter is being asked about the decision that he has just made. I'm going fishing, and how he's going to go forward. I think Jesus is saying, Peter, I know you're struggling. I know you're sorry. I know you regret what you did. But now I find you fishing. That's not what I called you to do, Peter. So tell me, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me more than these things? Do you love me more than your boat? Do you love me more than your nets? Do you love me more than this previous occupation of fishing? Because I know these things have provided for you, and I know these things give you some sense of security, some sense of comfort, some sense of stability, even some sense of identity. But in light of all that you have experienced, do you love me more than these things? When it comes down to it, are you willing to choose me over these things? And so Jesus asked Peter, Simon, do you love me? He asked him the question three times. Simon, do you love me more than these things? Simon, do you love me? Hey, Simon, do you love me? Now, there's a reason for this. Jesus isn't hard of hearing. He didn't, you know, not hear him answer the first time. He also isn't forgetful, and he didn't remember what Peter said the first two times. He knows that Peter has denied him three times by a charcoal fire. And so here, by a charcoal fire, Peter gets the chance to affirm to Jesus that he loves him. And that's what Peter does. Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He professes his love. He professes his commitment to Jesus. Yes, he loves him more than these things. But at the same time, Peter has also professed his love and commitment to Jesus before, hasn't he? Wasn't that what he did at the Last Supper? Even if these other heathens deny you or leave you, I won't. But he says a second time, a third time, yes, he loves Jesus. Yes, Jesus knows that he loves him. But on the heels of these affirmations, Jesus commissions Peter. Notice he doesn't commission him to fishing. He commissions him to ministry. Peter, do you love me more than these things? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. If you love me, then guess what you need to do? You need to feed my sheep. I didn't call you to sit in a boat and fish. I didn't call you to fish for fish. I called you to proclaim the gospel. I called you to share the gospel. I called you to feed my lambs. Peter, feed my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Then tend my sheep. Your calling isn't to be out here fishing. Your calling is to lead my people. It's to share the good news with them. It's to disciple them so they can grow, so they can mature in their faith. Tend my sheep, Peter. Hey, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord. You know everything. You know that I love you. Then feed my sheep. Because Peter, you are my disciple. You are sent with a message that will bring salvation to the entire world. And that's what you are called to do. So share it. Tell it. Feed my sheep. Some people refer to this as the recommissioning of Peter, but whether he's recommissioned or just reminded, Peter is told what he is supposed to be doing. And what he is supposed to be doing is the work of the kingdom. He's supposed to be doing ministry. He is reminded of Jesus' calling on his life. He is reminded of where his heart is supposed to be and what he is supposed to be doing. He is reminded what's truly important for him and for his life. And Jesus shows that Peter's calling is to follow him. Whatever that looks like. Whatever that means. As Jesus finishes this conversation with Peter in verse 19, notice how he concludes. The very last two words are, follow me. Not follow anybody else, not follow anybody else's plan, anybody else's understanding of what he needs to be doing. He is to follow Jesus, whatever that looks like. This is the initial calling that Jesus issued to Peter. Follow me and I will make you fish for people. Follow me as your rabbi, as your Messiah, as your Lord. And Jesus shows that calling has not changed. He is still to follow Jesus' calling on his life. He is still to follow as Jesus' disciple. To encounter Peter should be the same thing as encountering Jesus. Think about that principle of authorization that we talked about last week. That to go in place of someone else is the same as that individual going. And so as Jesus is sent and Peter is sent in Jesus' authority, then it's just like Jesus going. And so Peter is sent by Jesus. He represents Jesus just like if Jesus was there instead. Peter is to follow Jesus so closely that his actions, that his words, that his attitudes, that his perspectives are those of Christ. That he is evidence of Jesus. He is to follow in ministry because he is sent to represent Jesus. You notice that Peter is told to feed lambs, to tend sheep, to feed sheep. That idea of feeding, tending, caring for, helping, those are all ministry related. And so Peter is to follow after Jesus. You know, as I read this passage, as I think about Peter's story, I can't help but think how many people I know, how many people I know of whose story is very much like Peter's. Maybe you know someone whose story is very much like Peter's. Or maybe if we're honest, maybe our own story is like that. Because I think we can all relate. How often have we done something similar? Make a bad choice, say something we shouldn't have said, do something we shouldn't have done. Maybe we didn't react well, respond well. Maybe even let a situation or what was going on around us influence us and we responded poorly. It could have been something that we knew better to do. Might have even been something we said we would never ever do in a million years. And yet we did. And after the fact, we felt like we were damaged goods, second rate, missed the cut. We blew it and we messed up. And on the heels of that, we may have even asked some pretty significant questions. Man, I did that. What good am I? If I did that, what can I do for the kingdom? How can I still be used by Christ? How can I still be used for the kingdom? We might have even thought we should just go back to the way things used to be. To go back to what we used to do, to go back to the way things were, to just stop. Pick up the pieces as best we can and go in a different direction. I won't ask for a show of hands, but I'm guessing we've all probably been there. We've all felt like that at one time or another. But I want you to focus on what Jesus shows Peter this morning in this passage, because it's what he tells us, it's what he shows us today. That those things, whether they're things that bring us comfort, things that are familiar, things that may have defined us in the past or offered us security and stability. We have to be able to look at that and answer that question, how important are those things to us? Where's our heart? Where's your heart? Because Easter reminds us just how much Jesus loves us. He loves us enough that he went to the cross for us. He loves us so much that no matter what we have done, we cannot make him love us any less. Think about that. The worst thing you've done has never made him love you any less than he loves you right now. The converse of that is also true. No matter what kind of great and wonderful things you do, you cannot make him love you anymore. Do you know why? Because he loves you for you. I know that blows my mind, because I know what I'm like. And I know sometimes I'm not very lovable. You don't need to amen that, honey. But there's nothing you can do that can make Jesus love you any more right now or any less right now than he loves you. And even if you're like Peter and you've made some kind of bad choice intentionally or unintentionally, Jesus still loves you. And he still offers you forgiveness. And he still has a place for you in the kingdom, and he has a plan for your life. He wants to use you because he has a kingdom purpose for you. But the question we each have to be able to answer is, where is our heart? Where is your heart? What's most important to you? What do you value most? Do you love him more than those things you have a tendency to turn toward or to gravitate toward when things are difficult? Do you love him more than those things that have defined you in your past or that you're even inclined to allow to define you now? Do you love him more than those things? Because if your heart is beating and you're breathing, then he has a plan and a purpose for you. And his plan involves you being a part of the kingdom. His plan involves you being a part of the church. His plan involves you being a part of the ministry of the church and the ministry of the kingdom and the ministry that he has planned for you as an individual and in your church. That's why he calls you to do ministry. Maybe not like Peter did, but he still has a kingdom plan for you. A plan that's going to involve feeding lambs and tending sheep. A plan that involves the business of the kingdom and the ministry of the church and making a difference in the lives of people that you know or may not even know yet. His calling for you is to follow him. Just like he called Peter, just like he called numerous other believers, he calls you to follow him. To follow him so you can be more like him, to follow him so he can mold and shape you into the follower, the believer he would have you to be, to follow him so that you can use the spiritual gifts and the talents and the abilities and the personality that he has implanted into you for the kingdom, to make a kingdom impact and an eternal difference. He calls you to follow him because he has sent you out in his authority to represent him to your world. You're going to encounter people I'm never going to encounter. You're going to have the opportunity to be the hands, the feet, and the mouthpiece of Jesus that I'm never going to be able to see or interact with. Because he has called you, and he wants to use you. As we look at this passage, I see that Peter made that commitment. He chose to follow him. He chose to be who Christ had called him to be. But the question is not, what did Peter do? It's, what will you do? What decision will you make this morning? Let me throw in another tidbit here that may or may not be useful. Did you notice how many fish they caught? It was a lot. 153. And not only are there 153 fish, there are 150 large fish. But me being me, with my favorite question being why, I look at this and I say, why? Why 153? Why not 152? Why not 154? Why 153? Now I know some people are going to say, well, the obvious answer, dummy, is because that's how many there were in the net. Okay. But why were there 153 in the net? Do you know how many countries there were in the world in that time period? I'll give you a guess. It's 153. And those 153 fish quite possibly represented the 153 countries in the world around them. And it was reiterated to Peter who and what he was called to be and what he was supposed to be doing. Because he was supposed to be fishing for men. And where was he supposed to stop? When do you get to stop? We see the gospel is supposed to be going out to all people. It still goes out to all people, to every nation, throughout the world. That was Peter's calling. That's still our calling. But the question that Jesus asks us and that question that he asked Peter is, where is your heart? And will you make the decision to follow him today? Our musicians are going to come. They're going to prepare to lead us in their song of response. But as they come, perhaps this morning you're here even watching online and you know that you don't have a relationship with him. Maybe you realize that you don't have his forgiveness, but you need it. Maybe you need the purpose that he offers and you need that relationship with him and you've become aware that you can make that decision this morning. You can make that decision to put your hand in his and to begin to walk with him and to follow him and receive that forgiveness and that relationship and that purpose, and you can be changed and different from this point going forward for the rest of your life and into eternity. Do you need to do that? Because if you do, let me encourage you to make that decision this morning. Or perhaps you are here this morning or you're watching and you already know him, you already have a relationship with him. Maybe you've been reminded that some of your choices don't really reflect that relationship. Maybe you recognize that you've not done what you should be doing, or maybe you've even done some things that you know you shouldn't have done. Some of you may even feel like you've kind of turned off the path and gone way, way, way far afield. And you're wondering if you're beyond hope. Maybe even wondering if you're redeemable. Let me remind you this morning that you are just as redeemable as Peter was. That just as Jesus did for Peter, Jesus offers you that opportunity for a new start this morning and some new direction. That as he calls you to follow this morning, you have that choice to make. What will you do? As he calls you to use your life in ministry, as he calls you to participate in the ministry of the church, as he calls you to make a difference for the kingdom, how will you respond this morning? Maybe you're sitting here saying, but I got this stuff. Maybe you need to bring that stuff to him this morning. Maybe you need to surrender that stuff to him this morning so that you can be used by him to feed his sheep and to be involved in what he would have you to do. But that starts with you. Will you make that commitment this morning? Because he calls to you just as he called to Peter. Follow me. Will you make that decision to follow him this morning? Our musicians are going to lead us in our song of response. If you need to respond to him this morning, will you do that as we sing? Let's stand as we sing.
Reason, Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for these gifts that are about to come to you. We ask you that as we come, fill us with your love and your goodness. We ask that these gifts are used in the best intended way, and just like the gifts that you give us each and every day. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
Looking ahead at the calendar of events, this week we have a ladies' night out at McAllister's on Tuesday at 5:30, and a Tuesday night Zoom Bible study at 6:30. On Wednesday at 6:30, we have ladies' ensemble practice, and on Thursday we have handball practice at 6:30. I did want to let you know that next Sunday, if you are a part of church council, we will have a meeting at 4:00. And then there will be more information to come for Parents' Night Out and our next Youth Night. So, thank you.
Well, we have gathered to worship, to encounter the living Savior, to sing his praise, to pray together, to study together, to learn together, and enjoy the blessing of corporate worship. And now let us go forth and minister in his name. And as you go, may you go forth this day into the activity as companions of Jesus Christ, the Lord, and follow him, sharing his grace, that you might be used further the kingdom this week. Amen.